Hello, welcome to circuit simulation and modeling. Today, we are going to develop a modified nodal analysis stamp for mutual inductance. Before we do that, however, let us review the model that we are going to use for mutual inductance. Let's say we have these two inductors, L1 and L2. If there is no coupling between them, we can write the simple inductor model for each of them. So for inductor L1, we have V1 equals L1 di1 by dt. In other words, a change in I1 will induce a voltage across L1 due to its self-inductance. And we can do the same for inductor L2, where a change in the current I2 induces a voltage V2 across L2. So far, we have two regular inductors without any coupling between them. And their MNA stamp would be the same stamp that we have developed so far for inductors. Now let us consider the case where there is coupling between L1 and L2, resulting in a mutual inductance M. In this case, we need to add an additional term, M di2 by dt, to the voltage V1. In other words, there is an induced voltage at the terminals of L1 due to the change in the current I2 in L2. This, of course, is due to the coupling between the two inductors. And the same happens at L2, so we need to add M di1 by dt to V2. M, of course, being the mutual inductance. The value of M is given by K square root of L1, L2, where K is the coupling coefficient. When K is 0, there is no coupling, M is 0, and we are back to the simple inductor model. When K is 1, we have the ideal case of perfect coupling, where there is no leakage flux. And in the general case, K is between 0 and 1. Now, if we look at a typical spiced netlist representation of two coupled inductors, we find that each inductor is first listed separately and its self-inductance specified. For example, L1 is an inductor between node N1 and node N2 with a self-inductance of 10 nanofarads. L2 is similarly defined in the netlist. The mutual inductance is defined separately using the K element, which specifies the coupling coefficient K. In this particular example, K is set at 0.8 in the netlist. Another important point is that we need to specify which node is the dotted node in each inductor. By convention, the first node listed for each inductor is the dotted node. In this case, it is node N1 for L1 and node N3 for L2. Now we are ready to develop a stamp for mutual inductance. As usual, we will start by analyzing an example, and then we will deduce the stamp by inspection. Let's look at this circuit containing two coupled inductors and write the nodal equations. We start with Kirchhoff's current law at node 1. Here we have the current in resistor GS, GS V1 minus V2, plus the current IS in the voltage source. Remember, in modified nodal analysis, we always need to add the current in a voltage source as a variable. Next, we write KCL at node 2. Here we have the current in GS as well, but going in the opposite direction. So GS V2 minus V1 plus the current I1 going into inductor L1. Again, remember that in the MNA formulation, we always need to add the inductor current as a variable. Finally, we write the last KCL equation at node 3. Here we have the current in resistor GL, GL times V3, plus the current I2 in inductor L2. So we have three nodes, and therefore three KCL equations. But we have six variables, because we added IS, I1, and I2 as additional variables. So we need three additional equations. The first is the voltage source model, V1 equals VS. We saw this when we developed the stamp for voltage sources. The two last equations are the inductor models, including the mutual inductance. So for inductor L1, we have V2 equals L1 di1 by dt plus M di2 by dt. And for inductor L2, we have V3 L2 di2 by dt plus M di1 by dt. This completes our equations. Now let us look at them in matrix format to see if we can deduce a stamp for mutual inductance. First, as an exercise, let us see if we can identify the stamps of the elements that we have seen so far. Resistor GS is connected between node 1 and node 2, so its conductance appears in row 1, row 2, column 1, column 2 of the MNA matrix, where we have GS, minus GS, minus GS, GS. GL is between node 3 and ground, and therefore appears on the diagonal at row 3, column 3. For the voltage source, we need to add a new variable IS, and a new row, a new column to the MNA matrix. In this case, it is column 4, which is the one multiplying the new variable IS, and row 4, which contains the model equation for the voltage source. The stamp would then consist of a 1 in row 1, column 4, which is essentially adding the current IS to the KCL equation at node 1, and a 1 in row 4, column 1, which, along with the VS in the right-hand side vector, is telling us that V1 equals VS. Okay, now we can look at the stamp for the coupled inductors. Let us first take a look at L1 while ignoring the coupling. What we see in blue is the regular inductor stamp without the coupling. This is the inductor stamp that we have seen already before. We have the additional current variable I1. We have an additional column in the matrix which corresponds to I1, in this case column 5. The entry 1 in row 2, column 5 is simply adding I1 to the KCL equation at node 2. There is also an additional row, in this case row 5, which contains the inductor model. For now, if we look at the blue entries only, we simply have V2 equals L1 di1 by dt. In short, what we have so far in blue is the regular inductor stamp that we have already seen before. Now, if we look at L2 while ignoring the coupling between the inductors, we also need to add a new variable I2, a new corresponding column, and a new row. What we have now in green is the regular inductor stamp for L2, ignoring the mutual inductance. Now we can look at the mutual inductance. Its contribution to the MNA appears in the C matrix as the off-diagonal entries in the new row and new columns associated with the two inductors, as we see in red, minus M and M. So the strategy is then to add the two inductor stamps first and treat the mutual inductance as its own element with a stamp of minus M as the off-diagonal entries. Now we can generalize a stamp for two coupled inductors connected between nodes J, J prime, K, K prime. In the G matrix, we only have the regular inductor stamp for each inductor. Remember, the mutual inductance term M appears only in the C matrix. So we have a new row and a new column for L1, and a new row and new column for inductor L2. Also, it is implied that we will have two new variables in the vector of unknowns X, which are of course the currents I1 and I2 in the inductors. So when we have a plus 1 and minus 1 in row J and row J prime, for example, we simply are adding the inductor current I1 in the KCL equation at node J and subtracting it at node J prime. So far, we have two regular inductor stamps and we have not seen the impact of the mutual inductance. In the C matrix, we have L1 and L2 on the diagonal as part of the regular inductor stamps. Remember, these appear in the diagonal entry corresponding to the new row and new column for each inductor. The mutual inductance appears off-diagonal in red. From an implementation perspective, your code will need to keep track of which new row and which new column is associated with which inductor in order to know where to put the minus M if it encounters a K element. But you will need to keep track of that anyway, so it is not really an extra burden. At this point, I should probably say a few words about the dot convention. You may have seen the mutual inductance model presented with a plus or minus sign. The sign of M would depend on the relative orientation of the windings in the two inductors. The dot indicates this orientation so we know whether we have a positive or a negative mutual inductance. We have already seen the case where the mutual inductance is positive. If the dot is on the opposite side, the windings would be in a different orientation, the induced voltage is now in a different polarity, and we have a negative mutual inductance. Hence the negative sign in the equation on the right. The question is then, do we need to consider two different stamps? One with a positive mutual inductance and one with a negative mutual inductance? The answer is no, but let us see why. Here we have defined the current I2 as entering from the positive terminal, which is consistent with the passive sign convention. What if I decide that the current should always be defined as entering the dotted node? In this case, we need to move I2 to node N4. As you can see, now I2 is defined as flowing in the opposite direction as before. In order for the equations to remain unchanged, we need to change the sign of the term I2 in the equations. Okay, now the model equations are consistent with the new direction of I2. Notice that we now have a positive mutual inductance in the first equation. But in the second equation, we have minus L2 di2 by dt. The minus sign here is also consistent with the passive sign convention. After all, we have defined I2 as entering L2 from the negative terminal, at least based on how V2 is currently defined. So in order to keep using the standard form of the passive sign convention, let us flip the orientation of V2. Now the equations are wrong again, and we need to adjust the sign of V2 in the equations in order to take into account the new orientation. Okay, now we have minus V2 and the equations are correct again. All we need to do now is flip the sign of the second equation. Now we have the same model as before, with a positive mutual inductance. All we have effectively done is exchange the nodes N3 and N4. In fact, this is exactly what is done in a spice netlist. For the first two coupled inductors, we have L1, N1, N2, 10 nanofarads, and L2, N3, N4, 40 nanofarads. For the second pair of coupled inductors, we now have L2, N4, N3, 40 nanofarads, so N3 and N4 are flipped in the netlist. As I mentioned before, the convention is always to put the dotted node first. So the moral of the story is that we only need one model and therefore one stamp.